Today I'm going to take a look at some childhood memories. Have you ever felt like you wished you had your first car back? It might have been a piece of crap, and it might have been a rust bucket, or a piece of junk, but still it represented a change in your life and new freedom and a turning point, perhaps. Well, I kind of feel like that about my first computer, and I thought I had lost it, and I sort of had, but the deal is, back in the 80s, I bought my Commodore 64, and a few years later, I bought my second computer on Commodore Amiga, and I needed money for a new computer, and so I sold my first computer, and I sold it to my grandfather with the sales pitch that he could use it to index all his music. He had an extensive catalog of music on mostly vinyl, but also some tapes, and he had a paper card-based index of all his music. So I wrote a program that could help him keep track of it as a database with search facilities. But the truth of the matter is that that program wasn't very good, and the computer probably wouldn't even have the memory needed to store all of his music in memory. And yeah, I also know he mostly bought it to, at a premium price to help me fund my new computer. So sadly, he died in the early 90s. Passed away a few months before my mother did, and so I never got to ask him what happened to my old computer. And I figured he had sold it. I believe I had heard that he sold it a little while later, and I didn't care about it back then. But when in the later years, I kind of wish that I hadn't sold it, but I had to, So a few years ago, my grandmother passed away, and we were cleaning out her home, and this year we went through the final number of boxes that we haven't been looking at, and so the family was gathered and to take a look at it, and one of my cousins said that, "You know what? I think we found one of your other cousins' Commodore 64," thinking that it was something that didn't come from my grandmother's house. And then I immediately thought, hey, maybe it's actually mine. And so I asked, did it come with a printer? And they said, yes. And then I said, did it come with was it a Saikosha GP100 VC with a smoky clear plastic on top of it? And they said, yes. And I don't know why I can remember it's a Saikosha GP100 VC. I think it is. And so we went to the attic and took a look at it, and the first good sign was this cardboard box here. It's some medical equipment that would be around the house at that time. So that's a good sign at least. And so I opened it, and I'm going to share it with you today, and I had a brief look at it. It contains a number of things, spiders. There is this sampler 64. Hope it's not too fuzzy on the camera here. A sound sampler, and indeed the Saikosha GP100 VC. And this sampler were something that I know was mine because it has this weird wire connected to it. Originally there were a connection inside of it, and then I extended it out on this cable here, and it was a modification I made because it made it easier to connect to the computer. So this definitely is, at least this part is mine, and this one has, oh, this has gone loose, but I probably won't be using that again. So what this thing did was it connected to the computer and enabled me to record audio. In the 80s, computers could make something that sounded like music, or even home computers, but most people hated it. I thought it was cool, but anyway, so this one could record at like 3 or 4 seconds, and it sounded terrible. But I have been reading music magazines about, you know, Fairlight synthesizers and stuff like that, where you could record things onto it and play it back on a keyboard, musical keyboard that is. And I wanted to do that as well, so I could do this with this sampler, although it did sound like crap. So, but at least this was mine, and I think I did see a receipt in there. No. So, well, so that is at least mine, and it is really funny to see this after all these years. I don't think after 30 years there's any chance of me getting ink on my fingers, actually. So, I think I spotted something. Ha! Oh yeah! My tape recorder, that's funny. Holy crap. It's broken. I don't think I need tapes with programs on it anyway, so the Christmas decorations, part of something, I think. Yeah. What the hell is this? Is that? Ah, well, this is not from my computer. That's interesting. So a tape recorder, my tape for loading in programs, and my sound sampler, and this is, what the hell is this? Amstrad. Huh. It seems like my grandfather did play with computers more than I figured. I think one of his friend's sons had an Amstrad, but now my brain might be constructing memories right now. So he might have been buying some other stuff, actually, or two. Interesting. But this does look like my printer. This one were, I think Commodore made this and, or bought this and rebadged it as their product as well. So I can't remember where I bought it from, but I think I bought it used. So this isn't the computer. This is some of the things I could connect to my computer. So let's take a look at my computer instead. I think it's in this one, actually. Yeah, let's see. Okay. How do I open this? Zip. Ha ha! Oh yeah. The receipt for the audio sampler, like 800 kroner, so that's a bit more than $120, so it would be, what, $240, $50 in today's money. Interesting. What else? Ha! Yeah. This is, oh yeah. This is the program I wrote somewhere. Error program, test. This doesn't make any sense. The name of their vacation house? Interesting. I don't know if these are readable after all these years. This is protection for the disk drive, printer manual, cassette manual, user manual in Danish. I have spent so much time reading in this. I didn't know any English at the time I got this computer, and I remember reading this, and this was one of the reasons I were interested in learning a different language than Danish, because I had to be able to read this book and the other ones that came with it. So, and it's a Commodore 64. Is it mine? Power. Oh yeah, yeah. Oh, it's mine. Okay, so yeah, I was this thing here, these LEDs, those are something it's a modification I made to the computer, and I really had a, it wasn't easy for me to make modification of things because I really would like to take good care of them, and so making a permanent modification was always hard. I was afraid to ruin it. So, but basically this was 8 LEDs that I could turn on and off if I programmed them right, and they are connected to, oh yeah, you can see the wires here, connected to the user port. I don't think you can see that. So a few wires in here, soldered on. And that isn't something I put on, I painted on. Oh well, so I could this is like a parallel port. We don't even use parallel ports anymore, but it's an I/O interface, and you could program it very easily. And I had this idea that I would like to make something, some sort of a program that could control things with the computer, and I didn't have the skills to build any hardware that I could control, but I could install these LEDs, and I could write, I called it a sequencer, where I could control when these should go on and off and at intervals. And then I made a user interface for that could save and load these sequences onto the floppy disk, which is this one. And so this is my computer indeed. How cool is that? And this is the power supply for it. I know these are different depending on where in the world. I know why this is so yellow. My room was sometimes really cold in the winter, and because we had disconnected the electrical heat, it was too expensive to spend money on heating. We used a stove in the middle of the house, and so my room got quite cold in the winter with ice on the inside of the window. So I remember warming my feet on this. So 30 years old foot sweat. The Epix fast load. This is like a turbo module for made the floppy disk faster. Interesting, 1984. I haven't seen any of this in 30 years, so how cool is that? Yeah, I'm so happy to see this, because this is what the first computer I really learned how to use, and strictly speaking, it wasn't my first computer. I had one before this, and a VIC-20, but I quickly replaced it with this one because it was so much better. And I learned how to program it and make programs in assembly, and well, actually opcodes, as they're called. And I was ripping music and graphics out from games. I think we called it ripping. I can't remember right now. But basically I became fairly good at it, so I could make made all the memory scroll across the screen, like if you've seen The Matrix with the green graphics, not as fancy, just 2D, but the same thing, and it was just a jumble of characters. And then when they scrolled past fast on the screen, I could see peasants in all this, just like the guys in the Matrix did, and say, I could see, hey, here comes the music, for example, and here's some graphics, and here's the program code itself, and all this weird pattern. I could see what the parts of the memory were, and even who made the music sometimes, and I say, and here's the music, and hey, it's Rob Hubbard, or looks like his sequencing code. The people writing music on for the Commodore 64 games were very popular, and sometimes the game sold mostly on who had written the music, and there was Rob Hubbard and Martin Galway, and even someone from Denmark. I forget his name now. I think he makes music for movies now or games as well. I can't remember. But all of these people continue to have a career with music, it seems, a lot of them at least. And so I learned a lot from this computer, and I think one of the things that frustrated me about it as well was that I could write all these small programs and get them to work, but I couldn't construct a big program, a really complicated program, because I was in school like seventh grade, something, eighth grade. So I knew, I just learned some English and could read the manuals and could program some things, but I couldn't organize my code into a big structure. If I had a problem or something I wanted to do, I just attacked it head on instead of dividing it into smaller problems and solving them. And it was something I learned myself to do along the way. And just before I sold it, I was writing small code samples, like different types of graphic animations, and I would type this on the typewriter and make documentation and say, use this function to call this and call that, and I would bring it to school the next day to some of my friends and say, I made this cool new routine that makes a scroll line in a specific way, and if you call it with these parameters, it will do this, and it will stop, and it will go backwards, and it will enlarge. So that's the Commodore 64 and the floppy drive. This were fairly expensive, if I'm not mistaken. And in the beginning, I figured that I would never be able to get one of these because they were so expensive. The whole setup here were expensive. But somehow I got the money. I saved some money, and then I'm sure my parents helped me a lot to get this as well. So I actually had a summer job at one point to get a new computer. That's a different story. That would be so illegal today to to put children to work in a cleaning up a factory. With what's it called, precious water jets and stuff like that could take off a finger. Oh well, it was a different time back then. Excuse me. So I'm not going to turn it on today. I would like to, but I'm kind of afraid that I will break it. So what I am going to do is, if I get around to powering it up, I'll make a video about that as well. And I think I will take it apart and see how it looks on the inside, if there's anything that crawled in and died in here. And probably also measure this thing here, if that's... Probably make a new power supply, because it could blow up and ruin everything, even if it did work. And the floppy drive has movable parts, so there's some grease that probably also have turned into not concrete, but something. it's probably not going to move if I power it up. So. But unlike the mid-80s, today we do have the internet, so I can spend some time finding resources on restoring all this old gear, and that is definitely something I would like to do in the near future. I still have a box of floppy disks, actually, with all my old programs I made myself, and I have been dragging them along with me for 30 something years, and I don't think they're readable anymore because those are magnetic, and you know, what are the odds? I'm not entirely sure I will be able to read them, but well, I'll say this, even if none of this works, even if it's all dead, I'll still keep it. I will not throw it out ever. Yeah, so that's, I think I'll better stop now because I could talk for hours here and how long? Well, 20 minutes? 21 minutes now. Okay. We'll keep this to 21 minutes, and if I have some progress in with this, I'll make a different video about that, and instead of having a 4-hour video about me talking about crap. So, yeah. A sad and happy story at the same time, I guess. Yeah. So see you around, and have fun on the interwebs.